afternoon, South Africa, and a very warm welcome to you. I'm Jeannie D.
And I'm Bonnie Bully. It's almost spring. I'm so excited. Yes, I look very springy today. I love all the spring flowers. And of course, today we've got all this fashion and beauty tips from some of South Africa's best. And it's the final installment of our Skip My Fabulous Fashion series. And thank you so much for sending us all your My Fabulous pictures, and we can't wait to share them with you.
Well, I can share your sentiments with, we cannot absolutely wait to get to spring day. This winter has been long, it has been cold, and I have not loved the long cold.
Well, not that you ever like caught on to winter. You were in summer all the way.
I have denial.
Now, it wouldn't be a Thursday without fashion here in the loft, and we have Suzaan Heyns joining us. She's brought along some amazing goodies to show us.
We also have former Miss South Africa Claudia Henkel in the loft, who's looking amazing, and we chat to even another former Miss South Africa, Melinda Bam, who was also in the loft recently. We're going to literally be getting under her skin and talking about how she keeps that face so beautiful.
But I hear Danilo's making some budgies in the kitchen.
I never know what that guy's
Deep-fried
up to.
Deep-fried budgies.
Thanks so much, ladies. Yes, good afternoon, South Africa, and welcome to Afternoon Express. My name is Danilo Aquiston, and today in the kitchen, we're making something delicious. I've got a story for you to tell. Last weekend, I had a little boy of about 9 years old walked up to me and said, you know what, Danilo, I want to come and cook with you on Afternoon Express because I want to show you how to make traditional Indian food. So I thought I'd put that challenge forward to Claire today and see if we can try something Indian. Can we?
Yes, indeed.
Yay. What are we making?
So we're making a delicately delicious red onion bhajji. So it's all about red onions today. They're sweet, tender, and just really fabulous in something like this. So it's almost like a fritter. And red onion's the hero. It really is going to be delicious.
Lovely. Looking forward to it. If you guys want that recipe and shopping list, afternoonexpress.co.za is where you can find it and cook along with us live on air. Otherwise, find us on Facebook and on Twitter and interact with us during the show today. Right now, though, we've got Claudia Henkel standing by on the couch with Jeannie D.
Thanks, Danilo. Now, she was crowned Miss South Africa in 2004 while being a full-time law student, and the following year went on to place a top 10 finish at the Miss Universe pageant. Since then, she's climbed the corporate ladder and now works in the world of PR and events. Joining us on the couch is the recently married Claudia Henkel.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm amazing. Thank you. Thank you for having me.
You always look just so magnificent.
Oh, thank you. And
just
you.
Just amazing.
And you.
I was wondering, how are you managing to be part of the corporate world now?
It's been, it was actually a big decision. I've always been in PR and events. I owned my own company. And then I decided last year I did a bit of retail, and I was always a contractor. And a wonderful opportunity came up, and I decided that's it. I'm going to go into the corporate world, but like from 8 to 5, which actually right now it's from 8 till 8 at night.
Yeah.
But my job is PR and it's events, so it's not sitting in front of a desk all the time. So it's been incredible, and I've had such great opportunities. And I think that for me, it just gets better and better.
Good. And I love that you're busy doing this, because I think what was always refreshing for you as a Miss South Africa, or for me about you as a Miss South Africa, was always that you've got such a great sense of humour and you're smart. So,
Thank you. I mean, naturally
you would go on and dominate the corporate world. And I always remember chatting with you, and we were always moaning about men. Claudia and I said, oh, can't find a nice boyfriend. Trying to find a nice boyfriend is like finding a unicorn in this town.
Exactly.
And now you are married.
Yes. Yeah, we got married in March.
Yes.
We got married on March 28th. And he's actually a Cape Townian, and he moved to Johannesburg. And we met...
For you?
No. No,
okay,
no, no.
So you moved when he moved
to
Joburg.
So he, it was actually, it's a funny
okay,
story.
Who is he? What does he do?
So who is he? What does he do? His name's Oren, and my new surname is Ristov, which sounds quite like a Russian model, so I was very happy with the surname. And he moved And he moved to Joburg, and we met 6 months later. A mutual friend said, you single? And then the rest.
He's not bad looking.
No, he's lovely. Hey?
The children lovely. Will be beautiful.
Yeah, no, no. Look, I love that 8-pack going around there. Hey?
Yes.
It's lovely. It's lovely.
And just you soulmates. You met and it was just meant to be.
No, look, I think that when he moved to Johannesburg, it's a story where he met a girl, and this girl met me a week later, and we didn't know her, and she asked me if I was single, and she said, I met this guy, he's just me from Cape Town. I said, okay, well, I'm out and about. And the next night we met, and we honestly moved in together 8 months later, and 5 years later we married.
Amazing. Yeah. Now, when are we going to have little Claudia Henkel, Russian Claudia?
Listen, I'm just in the corporate world now, but I can't wait to be a mother. So we are talking about it. He always says he wants a 7-a-side rugby team because the guys, apparently your son can never be shorter than the mother. So he says he's going to have a son with his build and my height, and he's going straight to Springboks.
Oh,
like
deal.
It ain't happening. Listen, I know how it works. I just want girls. So I know when the time is right. I got to wax.
I know you're in a completely different phase now in your life to when you were Miss South Africa.
Yes,
but take us back to when you were. I mean, how did your life change? And is your life what it is now as a result of because you were in Miss South Africa?
Absolutely, without a doubt. I mean, I was studying law full time, and I was... That was what I wanted to do. I wanted to become an attorney. I wanted to be admitted to the bar, and I wanted to save lives and whatever
now,
else.
Now, every now and then, you still get admitted to a bar.
Yeah,
just a different one.
Correct. Not on a bar, to a bar. Then I entered Miss South Africa. The reason being is because I was modelling. It was interesting because a lot of girls say to me, what advice do you give to young girls as models? And I say to them, don't make modelling your focus. Don't make modelling something that you want to do as a
career.
But
it's not a career.
It's not a career because it's not your, it's the client. Mm. So the client likes you or the client doesn't like you.
Exactly.
So where I was in my time is I was studying law and then I started booking more modelling. And then I felt a bit like a commodity. You know, I put on a garment and I'd walk on stage and there's nothing wrong with that. But for me, because I was studying law, for me it was, I wanted a voice. I wanted to use the Miss South Africa platform as a voice to, you know, my whole, you know, when I entered Miss South Africa, I wanted to start a human rights show. And I wanted to be on a talk show host, and obviously that's changed, and I've gone more into
that's
the corporate
job,
world.
That's my job, darling.
Yeah, so, and I want to talk about human rights and all of that. And I think after Miss South Africa, I decided you can either go one of two ways. Stay in the entertainment industry, which I did. I did a bit of modelling afterwards, but I was always in that kind of law, you know, mind frame. So I always wanted to be a corporate girl. And I think that without Miss South Africa, the opportunities that were given to me would never have happened. So it's an amazing opportunity, and it's, you're an ambassador for your country. So,
Exactly. You
know, you're there not only as a pretty face, you're there to meet politicians and fashion designers, and so that for me was a great, great experience.
Of course. But now with all of the good, there obviously is a lot of bad that comes with it.
Yeah.
And I think it's isolating sometimes, like, you know, when they say it's tough at the top.
Yes.
And then also I think you struggled a bit with being aware of what people were thinking of you all the time. That I remember there was a stage where you lost a lot of weight.
Yes.
What kind of pressure did you feel to be able to, because you're such a smart, strong, independent girl, and then all of a sudden, oh, I'm so skinny. And now you're being judged about that.
Yeah.
So take us through that part of your life.
I think
as well.
It actually happened before Miss South Africa. When I was doing law as well, and I started booking a lot of modelling jobs, and then I was booked for Cape Town Fashion Week and Joburg Fashion Week. And because I'm so tall, I'm 1.86 metres tall, which is, I mean, 6'2". And what I started seeing is that when I went to castings or when I was booked for a job, I would be put next to a girl that was 1.7, and the dress would look amazing on her. But it would be a bit tight on me because of my height issues. So I thought, okay, well, I don't want to, and it's humiliating. You actually feel the pressure because you stand there in a room of 15 other girls and you're the one that sits there and the dress is not right or this dress is too tight. And
it's got nothing to do with weight.
No.
It's just because you're a taller girl.
Be obviously, something that would fit, you know, a girl that's a little bit shorter than me would look completely different. So what happened was is that that affected me because it wasn't so much about my weight. It was how I felt amongst other girls. And I think that's what the modelling world does to you. And that's why you've got to have such a strong head on your shoulders.
Yeah.
And I came out of that because of Miss South Africa. I remember very clearly coming back from Cape Town Fashion Week and my head was in Miss SA 100%.
Yeah.
And my mom looked at me and she just said to me, listen, you look like a bag of bones. She says, if you really want Miss SA, you need to... You know, you need to pick up a bit of... I mean, I was very... I'm 1.86 and I was weighing 52.
I don't even weigh that, and I'm midget size.
Yeah, and I think... So Miss South Africa helped me with that as well. And it is. You're a human being. Mm. It's going to get to you, but it's humiliating when you go into a room with all these girls. And in the end, I should have just, you know, embraced that I was tall and not gone through that.
But now I think that's your voice, because you're doing a mentorship program, I think, now with all of the younger Miss South Africans coming through.
Yes.
What's that about? Because you obviously have a great message to teach.
So it's the mentorship program is not necessarily only for Miss South Africa. It is for young, aspiring Miss South Africans, but it's for any girl that kind of needs advice where they are. I mean, It's frightening that, I mean, I read on the news the other day about a 14-year-old German girl that jumped off a building.
I was upset when I read that.
It's terrible. And I think that there is, the reason that this is happening is because a lot of women are being, or a lot of young girls are being, it's peer pressure. Mm. And you're human and you feel it. And it gets to a stage where you can't talk to anyone. So I am almost a voice for the younger girls. I think that I can assist them. I mean, I've got a lifetime.
How do girls get hold of you then if they want you to be their mentor?
So my email address is freely available on anywhere on the website. So it's info@claudiahenkel.com. I get various emails. Some are about career paths. I'm finishing matric. Some are about Miss South Africa. Some are about modelling. And the strongest message I give to those is in terms of the modeling industry is that be careful not to get consumed by it, because it can just consume you, and it can change who you are in a matter of a night.
Claudia Henkel, I'm obsessed with you. I just want to give you a hug. You are so fantastic. Thank you for doing such beautiful work for the girls of South Africa.
Thank you.
Wonderful. But you're going to stay with us. After the break, Danilo makes us an Indian-inspired snack, and it's the final installment of our fabulous fashion series. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express South Africa. So in the kitchen today, we're taking a trip to India, which is an attack on the senses, but this dish is absolutely delicious. We're making a budgie, and not like the bird, I hope. Right. How do we get started?
That was a delayed day one. Oh, no one. Yeah, I wouldn't say an attack on the senses, but an enlightenment on the senses, an excitement on the senses. Lots of flavors, garlic, chilies, spices, just really synonymous
typical
with Indian
food.
Yeah. I'm not a pro at Indian food. I just love eating it.
Lovely.
So I thought, why not?
Well, I'm not a pro either, and this is one I've seen you create before, and it looks delicious, so I want to try and see if I can replicate it.
Yeah, so it's sort of like a fritter. We're using chickpea flour because it's got a great flavor.
Cool.
And we're just going to add that to the bowl, and then we're going to add our spices.
So I'm assuming you're making the batter now for the deep fry.
Indeed. So then some chili powder and some turmeric. That's going to add flavor and color to that. Cool. And then we're going to go to some of our garlic, our ginger, our chili.
Yeah.
And now we're going to slowly add our water. Do you want to do that for me?
Sure.
You want to sort of be mindful of the fact that you want a thick batter because it's got to hold the onions. So do a little bit at a time. Go for that. Just mix it up nicely.
So you want it almost like looking like a proper batter where it's
exactly
almost dry.
Exactly. So just a little bit past. Go for it. Pretty much there. So it's thick enough to coat, but not thin enough that the onion sort of just disappears out through the batter. Okay, so do you want to just dump all those in there?
Sure.
And then we're going to also add some of our onion seeds and some cumin seeds for some...
All of them? We're just going to take a little pinch.
So onion seeds have got quite a bitter flavour, but a great flavour.
Cool. I've never actually used onion seeds before or even seen them around. This is new to me.
Really?
Do they have actual flavour of an onion?
You confused thinking that they're sesame.
They do. They look like sesame.
Yeah.
Can I taste one?
Yeah, go for it. So the other name for it is Nigella seeds. And what do you think?
They kind of taste like a black onion and pepper. It's like onion and pepper combined.
Yeah. Okay, that's going to go in there. And then a little bit of the cumin seeds. And then just season. Salt and a little bit of pepper. Go for that.
Should we put in?
Go for it.
Go,
I love cumin.
Oh, really? Say when?
Yeah, done. Okay. And then just mix that all up. And then we're literally just going to dollop some into the batter. It's going to kind of
clump
and then also kind of just open up almost like a blossom. It looks so pretty.
It's quite thinly sort of coated, I see, which is awesome. I didn't know.
Let's just... Okay, should be... There we go.
A little bit hotter than that, I suppose.
No,
that's
perfect.
There we go.
So you can test the oil by just taking one of the onions, plopping it in there, and if it sizzles and bubbles around it like that, perfect. Let's go for another one. These are really simple to eat, and it's just a fantastic snack.
What do you serve this with?
Oh, so we're going to make a really yummy cucumber raita. So the cucumber raita is typically almost like a cooling dip. Mm. The cucumber, as we know, really helps sort of alleviate those chili kind of bites. So it is fantastic just as it is, but I think a nice little cucumber dip will be great with it. And it's a snack. It really is a snack. Like I said, I'm not a pro at Indian food, but I love eating this. It's so fantastic.
Well, what you've done basically is chosen a whole bunch of Indian flavors. You combine them together to create something that
is also not
Indian.
Incredibly traditional, but it's sort of my take on it, and it really is yummy. So
if
anyone who has a traditional recipe would like to share it with me, it'd be great.
Well, let me come and call that little boy who told me that he wants to cook some Indian food with us. I'll maybe bring him into the
loft. Yeah, maybe he should get his mom to give this a try and let me know how it is.
Fantastic. So you're going to keep carrying with those. We've got a whole bunch more to do here. We'll be creating the sauce later on Afternoon Express, so make sure you stay tuned for that. Right now, though, we're going to be joining Bonnie on the couch with Alexis as we talk fashion.
Thank you, Danilo. Now, after 12 weeks of fabulous fashion, it's the finale of the Skip Fashion Series. And what better way to salute South Africa's unique sense of style than for us to show off your fabulous, thanks to all of those pics you sent in via social media. And joining us in the loft is fashion director Alexis Chaffee-May, here to share her favorite looks and give us some handy fashion advice for fabulous style. My favorite fashion director and my favorite topic. Welcome to the loft.
Always good to be here.
Awesome. So now you've selected the finalists for the Your Fabulous competition.
Yes.
And what criteria did you use to select them?
Well, this season, you know, Skip's been all about showing off your fabulous. So above all, I picked the people that really looked like they just loved what they were wearing.
Right. And they were really feeling it.
They were just feeling it. They were in the zone because that's what it's supposed to be about. Yeah. You know, fashion's supposed to be fun.
Awesome. So let's go through them. First up was Bron Lee from Cape Town.
Yes.
Tell us about her.
So I love a really strong, you know, monochrome print. It makes such a statement, especially when paired with a solid color. Yeah. And this cobalt blue trouser that Bron Lee is wearing is just so on trend.
Yeah, it's
gorgeous. This outfit is actually a very flattering look. And it follows a couple of principles that I actually follow myself when I style women. Mm-hmm. And it's such an easy thing for you to do at home.
Right.
So you see that this vertical stripe leads the eye down on the body, so it's giving Bron Lee a little bit of extra height, and then that solid color is actually balancing out her body. And it's such a simple thing to actually balance out the proportions of your shape simply with what you're wearing.
Wow.
So the golden rule is the areas that you want to conceal, you wear a darker color, and the areas that you want to emphasize, you wear a brighter color or a print.
Or a print.
Now, Bron Lee, you can see she's a very well-proportioned petite girl.
Yeah.
So she's got plenty
of frame.
She
doesn't have to conceal anything.
Exactly. She's got plenty of frame to work with.
Yes.
But if there was an area of your body that you wanted to descale, then you could definitely, you know, re-pull the eye to the area that you want to emphasize with a brighter color, a more vivid print, or even a really big accessory. And it's such an easy way just to trick the eye. And you also see that with her tapered pant, she's wearing a heel. And, you know, a lot of women say, how can I wear a tapered leg? You know, it looks funny. I look like a carrot. But the second you wear a heel, it just elongates your leg and gives you that
and
extra height.
Your ankle
height.
Gives you that, like, delicate
absolutely.
Ankle.
Absolutely.
Well, I love her style. So next up we have Lavanya from Durban, right?
Yes.
What did we love about her?
So, you know, a key part about this whole series has been celebrating style from around South Africa.
Unique style, yes.
So, of course, I love Lavanya's, you know, Indian dress. Mm. And this is, I think, so signature to Durban. You know, Indian culture really has now become a little bit of a signature style in Durban. Yeah. And it's influenced their style quite a lot in terms of color and embellishment.
Right,
like this dress here, I love that embellishment around the neckline. It completely brightens up her face.
Yeah.
And I wish that more women would embrace their heritage and their culture. And, you know, dress in ways that kind of shows that off. And I think it's especially relevant when women modernize traditional garments in a way that is still, you know, completely sensitive and respectful to their culture or their religion, but in a way that can inspire other women that perhaps weren't raised the same way, but can still see the beauty in a traditional garment and how you can put that together in a modern society.
And then next up, we have Musa from Cape Town.
Yes, so Musa from Cape Town, first of all, he looks like a supermodel
and
oozes that Cape Town cool, which
it's quite an androgynous look he's got.
Yes,
going on
but that's so big in fashion, as we know. And he's wearing print. Now, print is such
a
big
trend. You have to be
brave
for print, though, hey?
I print on print. You know, people get so shy with prints.
I'm one of them.
But try it. I mean, even if you start very subtly, whether it be, you know, a shoe or a handbag or maybe just a little scarf, you know.
I couldn't do a print shoe.
Toe,
I couldn't.
Tip the toe into print. And, you know, this season, you know, print on print like this look is still a huge huge trend. And I think it's very signature to South African style.
Yeah.
Because if you were to look across the globe, I would think as South Africans and Africans, we're definitely far braver with prints and colors and wearing prints together. I mean, I go to our local fashion weeks and seeing the outfits that those women and men put together is just incredible.
No, it is incredible. I mean, when people do pull it off, it's just phenomenal.
Amazing.
And just watch
amazing.
With envy.
And I think also, I think, you know, your African culture and your African sense of style just does it so well.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it almost
oh, yeah.
looks so effortless.
Yeah. It also, I mean, needs that kind of a personality that's just going to carry it quite
absolutely.
Boldly here.
But that's everything about fashion. You
everything.
Know, you
no,
have
you're right.
to wear
you're right.
what you feel comfortable in
yeah.
and what celebrates you as a person. Because ultimately, it's the person in the clothes that makes the
yeah.
fashion significant.
Indeed. And lastly, we have from Joburg, Maradi, right? Tell us about Maradi.
Now, I love Joburg's sense of style because they really are, they are all in. And that's
all
what
in,
makes
yeah.
all in.
It's all or nothing, go big or go home.
And that's what makes
yeah.
Joburg style yeah. so amazing. You know, it's that really buzzing city and they're so in touch with the global trend. And Maradi's
and
wearing
so
a,
in your face.
So yeah. in your face, but in like, you know, a kind of, I don't know if you could say in a relaxed sense, but they're very confident
yes.
in the style that they bring
yes.
forward.
Yeah.
And you know, Maradi's wearing this super cute little street style look. You know,
it
the crop
it.
Shirt, the crop shorts with that very androgynous boot. I mean, this is what we see globally, but specifically, it's quite signature to big
yeah.
cities. Like Joburg.
Yes.
And street style, for the people that are still like a little bit uncomfortable with what that term means,
yes.
generally it's taking all those key trends of the season, mixing them up, but it's in a more accessible and a more functional way.
Yeah.
So street style is about functionality, it's about wearability.
Yeah.
We're seeing clothing that is, you know, more wearable, more washable. There's lots of pockets. We're seeing flat shoes and sneakers,
yes.
you know, still a massive must-have. Backpacks, it's about being on the go and wearing a look that works for you and you're free to move in it. You know,
yeah.
we see a lot of innovations now in fabric as well.
Yeah.
So, you know, you don't have to be like sitting so pristine in your outfit. You
yeah.
can really live in it. And in this way, you know, fashion, you know, as we say, has become a lot more functional and the consumer has actually overturned the runway, if you like, where we are now directing the look and the trends
awesome.
That designers are putting
it.
Forward.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's about making it ours,
yeah.
which is very exciting.
You know what I absolutely love about Maradi's look is that she's quite self-like. I mean, she's very thin, her frame.
Yes, I mean, fantastic body.
Yeah, awesome. Her legs are just to die for. But then she's wearing this, like, heavy, heavy boot. And,
yes.
I've always been afraid to wear, like, a Timberland with my legs because they're quite scrawny. And
no,
I just love
but
that
with
she's
your
made
look,
it look,
I mean, we spoke about the androgyny, which
yeah.
is, you know, really
yeah.
big in fashion at the
yeah.
moment. And I think this is what it's about. It's about that juxtaposition of femininity. I mean, she's obviously, she's a gorgeous, you know, sexy girl, and she can wear this, like,
yeah.
tough biker boot.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
it's about playing with it, and it's about the unexpected.
Yeah.
You know, it's not paint by numbers. You know, you
yes.
can add your own little flair in there, too.
I love it. Now, what I don't absolutely love is that this is the end of our Skip Fabulous
I
Fashion
know.
Series, right?
I know.
But it's been absolutely splendid. What do you hope that women have learned from the series?
I really sincerely hope that women have been inspired to be re-energized and to get dressed up in the morning, you know, because that's what it's about. It doesn't need to be painful,
yeah.
you know, and to also celebrate the style in our different
yeah.
cities and celebrate each other and, you know, find what's, you know, the unique, amazing things about us.
Yeah.
And whether you live in a tiny little village or a really big bustling hub, you can share your fabulous with everybody. And I
yeah.
think that's what it's all about. I mean, I'm so passionate about fashion and so is Skip.
Yeah.
So we get really excited to share that kind of love with everyone every season. And we really hope that every little part of South Africa has felt the love.
Yeah. And my saying is, like, whatever's going on in your life, you can get through it as long as you look fabulous, right?
Absolutely. But it's about feeling fabulous.
No, of course. But, I mean, you know, it's interchangeable. Like, they're,
yes.
they're dependent on each
Looking
other.
Looking good makes you feel good.
Exactly. Thank you so much, Alexis.
Always.
Today's your last chance to win a six-month supply of Skip. So grab your phone and SMS the keyword Skip and your name and city to 33728 and it could be yours. Don't forget, SMSs cost R1.50 and T's and C's apply. You can visit our website for details. After the break, we get under the skin with Melinda Bam, so don't go away.
Skip loves your clothes as much as you do.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. Now, when it comes to beauty, who doesn't want to know the secret to picture-perfect skin? Now, we're about to embark on an 18-week Getting Under Your Skin series where we're going to uncover South African celebrities' beauty secrets. And while we're at it, learn something about them that you probably didn't know. First up, we join someone who definitely knows a thing or two about beauty, former Miss South Africa Melinda Bam. Take a look. Former beauty queen Melinda Bam is known for her style and flawless skin. And as South Africans admired her face, she became fascinated with the faces of South Africa.
I'm Melinda Bam, and I think South Africans know me as a former Miss South Africa, perhaps even a beauty queen. But I'd like for them to think of me as a businesswoman and an entrepreneur as well. Something that I think South Africa doesn't know about me is that I'm an artist. I think people see the blonde hair and they see the evening gowns, but they don't know that I've got a sincere love and passion for art. And I focus a lot on sketches of people and our faces and features. And I think that's probably the most beautiful part that you can capture of South Africa. And that's definitely something that I'd love to showcase to the world. Ever since I started sketching people's faces and painting, I almost became so incredibly aware of the fact that your skin is probably the most precious gift that you have that you need to take care of, because I focus literally for hours on end on people's skin and on their faces and the light little pores and shadows and marks sometimes. I think that's why I've started taking good care of my skin as well, because I know that that's the one thing that people will always see. They'll always look at that first. So why not take care of it?
On a warm winter's day in Johannesburg, Melinda let us in on the daily steps she takes to help her maintain radiant skin.
My skincare regime to me seems quite basic, but it consists of 5 to 6 steps sometimes. And it's become so part of my daily routine that it goes by so quickly anyway. So I start off by using a pre-cleanse to remove all of my makeup to make sure that there's nothing left. Then cleanse, exfoliate, either with an exfoliate brush, which really comes in handy when you wear a lot of makeup and you have to be in the sun quite a lot and you have to be outdoors, or enzyme exfoliator. And then to tone, moisturize, and then apply sunscreen in my moisturizer. I always make sure to use a moisturizer that has a 30 to 50 SPF in.
As we age, our skin begins to change and slowly loses its elasticity. However, maintaining a youthful glow takes a lot of healthy nutrition and discipline.
I've got a couple of don'ts that I really tend to pay attention to. The first one is definitely never to sleep with makeup. It doesn't matter how late you get in or how early you need to wake up in the morning or whatever, to make sure that you never, ever, ever go to bed with makeup so that the regenerative process in your skin can take place at night. And then never to leave the house without sunscreen. We live in South Africa, we have to wear sunscreen. Otherwise, we're going to look 50 when we're in our 20s. The other one is not to touch your face. I think we as women are very expressive and we talk with our hands and we touch people and we touch things and there's so much bacteria and things, and then we often speak and we touch our faces and we correct our lip gloss and rub our makeup off, and we don't actually realize how much bacteria we put on our face and that actually damages your skin. So those are the three big don'ts for me. Something that I really look out for in a product having very sensitive skin is that it needs to be a natural product. I don't use any products that have harsh chemicals in them or that are genetically modified or anything artificial, because I strive to have a natural looking, natural glowing skin, and how better to achieve all of that than with a natural product. And then of course to have a product that is catered to the South African climate. Our climate isn't like Europe, it's not like Paris or London where we get some of these brands. So I think it's really important to have a product that is also catered for our harsh sun, our dry conditions, and our cold winters as well. I think healthy eating and good skin goes hand in hand. People often tend to the external a little bit more than to the internal, but I think you reap the rewards far better with a healthy diet, drinking certain supplements like folic acids and things that really keep your skin healthy and glowing. I know that there are various products on the market. I know Emmadine, for instance, has a healthy anti-aging skin tablet that really has natural ingredients that make sure that you nourish your body from the inside out so that you can really start glowing from the outside. I think it is difficult in today's pace and the pace of society to make sure that you don't overexert yourself, and everything shows on your skin. So if you don't want to look 60 when you are 30, then start now. Start applying a healthy skincare routine to make sure that you take good care of yourself.
Now that woman is magnificent.
Yeah.
And that's quite a brave thing to do, is wash your face.
To take off all your makeup. I personally wouldn't do it. Just saying, just putting it out there.
And she was giving it a good rub as well.
I know.
Proper face wash.
Beautiful skin. It looks like a baby's bottom.
And she did make a really good point, though, which I find quite valid. Your skin, you can wash it and do whatever you want on the outside, but it's what you put on the inside, though, that really does reflect on the outside. So it's eating healthily, drinking lots of water. Yeah, she used that product, Imidine, that I've heard of because Christy Turlington is actually the global ambassador for it as well.
Yeah.
And Christy Turlington, well, I mean, she's
flawless,
a yogi.
Yeah. She's perfection. But I also find, sleeping, just exercise.
Yes.
And of course, just cutting down on the glass of wine a day.
Yeah,
that makes
a huge
difference.
Rubbish. If I have a really sugary binge, then I feel
like
then
it shows on your skin. I mean,
puffy.
If I just have to have a slab of chocolate and I'm done for, like I'll just get a big chorb the next day.
Really?
But you know what? Like, I can never emphasize enough the importance of drinking water.
Exactly.
So what I've taken to doing now every morning is before I wake up, before I even get out of bed, I have a glass of warm water with lemon daily.
Lemon water, I do every single day.
Life changing.
I don't drink tea or coffee. I drink lemon water as my tea in the day.
Yeah.
Oh, that is magic for skin.
And another amazing thing for skin is getting enough omega-3s, getting all your oils in.
Mm.
Yeah.
And she said, Melinda actually said that she uses folic acid as well. That is the most vital vitamin for anybody to use. Mm.
And I mean, I guess if you're taking your daily multivitamin, you're getting all of that in one little...
Exactly.
Power.
Beautiful skin all over. Someone else with sweet baby skin is Danilo. And he is going to be back making more of those little brudgies after the break.
Welcome back. Now, recently, Bonnie went on location to a beautiful, stained city apartment in Johannesburg to find out how tea can help you spice up your life. Take a look.
Welcome to another moment with Five Roses. Today, we're spicing things up with an invigorating chai tea, and we're chatting tea and spices with our favorite tea master, Dinesh. We also get cooking in the kitchen with an aromatic curry recipe. Welcome, Dinesh. It's lovely to have you with us again.
Thank you very much. It's good to be here.
Dinesh, what exactly is spiced chai tea?
Spiced chai tea originated in India. It's a black tea base and mixed with various spices. From region to region, these spices or the combinations change. So it could be cinnamon, cardamom, cloves, and any other spices that you could really think of. It's a beverage that has been made popular right throughout the world, and most countries now adopt this beverage, and it's loved everywhere. It's a warm beverage, it has a smoothing effect, it is good for your digestive system, and it's just something to make you feel good.
It's also popularly known as a tea that's very calming and soothing. Why is that?
I believe it is to do with the spices that are in the beverage and what is used. In the old days, those are the types of spices and products that were used for various medicinal purposes.
Thank you so much, Dinesh. Well, it was very interesting for me to find out that not only can you drink spiced chai tea, but you can also use it in an aromatic curry recipe. Manish is in the kitchen waiting to show us how. So we're about to make this aromatic curry recipe, of which the spiced chai tea is a key ingredient. How exactly?
I love cooking with spices, and the warm, fragrant spices in the chai tea work wonderfully with this aromatic curry.
Right, so we're going to make it a sauce of sorts?
No, we're going to infuse the coconut cream with the chai tea, and then we're going to add that to the curry.
I see we have some beautiful prawns.
Yes, these are large shell-on prawns, and they've been deveined.
Oh, sounds so delicious. Can we get started?
Yes, we can. We have coconut oil, we have curry leaves, mustard seeds, matchstick ginger, so it's just fresh ginger cut into matchsticks, crushed garlic, roasted cumin, roasted coriander, a mild chili powder, salt, red chilies, chopped shallots, crushed tomatoes, spring onions, and fresh basil. And then for the rice, we have butter, red chilies, broken cashews, coriander, and rice that's been infused with the chai tea. Okay, to get started, we're going to take our coconut cream and infuse that with our chai tea bags. Next, we're going to start with the curry itself. So that starts with the coconut oil. Once that begins to melt, we're going to add in some of our curry leaves, a teaspoon of mustard seeds, and just let that cook until the mustard seeds start to pop. Once they do, we're going to add in our fresh ginger, the fresh garlic, and our shallot. This is going to cook until it's golden brown. Next, we're going to add in our spices, such as the ground cumin, a teaspoon of the ground coriander, and 3 teaspoons of our masala. You can add more if you need to. A teaspoon of salt. Next, we're going to add in the crushed tomatoes. Stir that really well so that everything's incorporated. And we're gonna put the lid on and let that simmer for 10 to 15 minutes until the tomatoes are well cooked out. And while that's simmering, we're going to get started on our cashew and coriander rice. So first goes in our butter, curry leaves, dried red chilies, and a teaspoon of mustard seeds. Next, we're going to add the chopped cashews and let those start to toast. Here we have our basmati rice that's been cooked in the chai spice tea. Mix that so it's well coated in the spices and nuts, and chopped fresh coriander. And we're going to immediately take this off the heat.
Once the tomatoes cooked through and the liquid reduced, add the coconut cream and simmer for 10 minutes.
Prawns are my favorite seafood.
Mine as well.
Cook the prawns and season with lime juice before removing from the heat and stirring through shredded basil and chopped spring onion.
Wow, Manisa, that looks absolutely amazing. I just can't wait to tuck in. And remember, nobody makes better tea than you and Five Roses. Till next week.
Any occasion, any time. Nobody makes better tea than you and Five Roses.
All right, so in the kitchen today, we're making a really cool Indian dish with us. It's called a bhajji, and we're about to make a raita, which is the sauce that you dip inside. It's apparently, you said, nice cooling element to that chili that you've got inside
the cucumber. Yeah. Cool as a cucumber is where the phrase comes from.
Oh, you've been spending too much time with me, Claire. Yeah. Too much time. So how do we make the raita?
Speaking of cucumber, we've just grated the cucumber, a normal typical box grater, into some muslin and into a sieve. And you just want to squeeze to get out all that excess liquid. Can you see how much liquid comes out? Because you don't want, especially if you're going to make this and let it sit again, you don't want all the liquid to kind of ooze out. You end up with a watery mess.
It's kind of got like a Mediterranean feel to it, because this is very similar to making your, what's that, Greek?
Tzatziki.
Tzatziki, yeah. Okay, so process.
You can go on the double cream yogurt. I choose double cream because something I'm just absolutely obsessed with. I think it's just such a good, creamy, rich flavor. Not traditional with this. It's typically going to be sort of a plain, lower-fat yogurt. And then into...
Our cucumber.
Okay, so then a little bit of salt goes in there again. And then some pepper. And we've got some yummy seeds here. Like I said, obsessed with cumin, obsessed with coriander. Mm-hmm. We're just going to pop that into our
pestle and mortar
and give that a crush. So I'm going to do that while you mix up there. Do you want to get some lemon in there?
Sure. How many?
Just
one half?
Just to taste. So
just to taste. So as much as I think is necessary.
Do you like it quite zingy?
I like quite a zingy.
Oh, that smells good.
Flavor.
And then in goes our seeds.
Half, I think, will do.
I love it.
Oh, that smells so good.
Hey?
That smells amazing. But I also know that this is, it smells almost got like a biltong taste to it, because you've got these cumin goes on your biltong, right?
The coriander.
Coriander
seeds.
That's it.
Very, very good nose there, Danilo.
Yes, I've been told. I know I've got a big nose, but it does know how to smell too.
So a little trick of mine,
yes,
like moving on swiftly, is to cut your herbs with scissors. If you want to, just because, so if you're going for like a roughly chopped look, go for it with a knife, totally fine. But quick and simple, if you sort of present it, look how delicious and golden
really
the bhajji
amazing,
look. You're just going to chop this over, and just for sort of serving it, it just makes it easy. Look how easy that is. Obviously clean kitchen scissors, don't use the ones that you're like...
Yeah, yeah. Use for your hair or something.
This is packed full of flavor, all those herbs and spices. This is also packed full of flavor, all those herbs and spices again. Mm. So put the two together and it's really, really delicious.
You won't find this in any recipe book other than our website, afternoonexpress.co.za. This is where you can find this recipe and shopping list. Make sure you download it and you make some amazing dishes courtesy of Afternoon Express and Claire Winstanley. Now, after the break, we take a look at some exquisite items from Suzaan Heyns. And don't forget to enter our Go Green SMS competition. All the details you need for this week's question are available on our website, afternoonexpress.co.za. Time is moving along very quickly, and you only have a few weeks left to be entered into our draw for that ultimate grand prize. But here is some more information. The Afternoon Express team is going green. Join us every Tuesday at 4 p.m. until September as we bring you the most innovative trends in sustainable fashion, food, decor and design, as well as handy tips to help you reduce your carbon footprint.
Answer our Go Green question every Tuesday and stand a chance to win R1,000 Woolies gift card every week.
Plus, simply by entering, you also go into the big draw for the ultimate grand prize worth over R500,000.
Including a dream sustainable kitchen makeover from Cordev, fitted with Bosch appliances worth R300,000. Also, up to R250,000 worth of home upgrades so you can live off the grid. Plus, food and homeware from Woolworths valued at R75,000. And a R25,000 towards a school of your choice with MySchool.
So, go big. Go green with Afternoon Express every Tuesday at 4 p.m. to win these amazing prizes.
Woolies and I collaborating to raise 100 million rand through the My School program. Are you with us?
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. Now, since the birth of her label in 2008, she has gained a cult following amongst the South African fashion fanatics due to her signature architectural and sculptural design approach. Joining us on the couch is Johannesburg-based fashion designer Suzaan Heyns. Welcome
Thank you.
To
Thank
Afternoon
you for
Express.
Having me. Yes.
So awesome to have you here.
Thanks.
You are such an exceptional designer because of the fact that you're an artist, above and beyond everything.
Yeah, I do believe, for me, fashion is art. You know, I always say that fashion can't inspire fashion. So it's about innovation and really leaning heavily on art referencing and things like that. It's about being a creationist, basically. So, yeah.
And you're always very brave to come up with new concepts and new ideas using architecture and sculpture as part of your shows. I mean, I remember the concrete show.
Yeah.
So how do you get that? How do you come up with those ideas?
You know, I think it's always, have I seen it? And if I think I haven't seen it before, then I want to do it. So, and I always say, do things that scare you. So every time I work in a new medium, so for instance, concrete, making concrete sculptures, or working with cork, or doing hand cutouts, or just kind of like playing around with things, because then that kind of filters down into something that is a little bit more ready to wear. But you have to push, because, I mean, we've got the freedom, we've got the creativity, why not do it? You've got that platform. So play. So I like to push.
So you're a very busy girl at the moment. You're busy moving your studio, you're busy moving house, you're planning a wedding, and you've been doing these incredible collections.
Yes, yes.
How do you fit it all in? And I mean, you've got, you do such amazing couture work and a lot of wedding design as well. How are you able to focus?
You kind of, I think it's that thing, give the busy person something to do, right?
Yeah.
But I've got an amazing team. I've got an amazing business partner, Moira Jensen, who kind of handles all the business sides of stuff. So that I don't know, I can focus on being creative. I've got wonderful interns. We've got beautiful intern programs. So they help me. And you just kind of have to do it. So, I mean, there's 24 hours in a day, right?
Definitely. Yeah. I read this quote the other day saying, you've got exactly the same amount of hours in the day as Beyonce. So don't
complain.
Now, you've just returned from Portugal where you did a fantastic show. And you're going to show us some of your pieces here.
Yes.
But what was the concept behind going to Portugal and putting this collection on?
Well, we got invited by Moda Africa, and it's a show that's all about sustainability. And so the inspiration behind the show was sustainability, and I kind of looked, you know, we don't necessarily all have sustainable fabrics that we can use, but what is sustainability within the fashion kind of realm? Now, wastage is huge. You know, they burn clothes. People, you know, they throw stuff away. It's about fast fashion. And so then taking something and saying, okay, well, it's not trend-driven. It is a piece of art. Everything is hand-done, beautifully kind of pieces put together. Mm. And then looking at what do I have lying around in the studio? And I've got lots of leather because I work a lot in leather, all these little offcuts.
There you can see some of your leather offcuts.
Oh, there we go. Yes.
And then, so that's where you've used it.
Yes. And so then also now saying things that scare me. I've never worked in African print before. So I thought, okay, well, let's be inspired by that. So looking at African print, looking at 3D, using all the offcuts, and then just kind of like making something that's kind of, it's got a bit of an African vibe, but it's forward thinking, you know. Yeah. And fashion also, when people think Africa, it doesn't always have to be Africa. It can be inspired and be something
it's
new.
It's futuristic Africa, actually. I love it. Yes. It's kind of, you know, I think I need Florence and the Machines and Mila Jovovich to wear your clothes.
That would be amazing. That would be great. Yeah.
Wow.
So the idea behind that is also layering upon layers on top of each other, so you get that kind of feeling of depth. And then also what we did is working with sustainability is working with cork fabric, which is 100% biodegradable fabric. And it really sews up like leather.
And
so
it's
cork.
Fabric
it's,
or
it's
cork?
Cork. It's just cork. It's amazing to work with.
Lovely.
And also it kind of forces you into looking at things that we've got lying around, doing paneling in a different way because I've only got smaller pieces. So it was interesting how that influenced the design process.
And your studio when you work in it, I mean, how sustainable are you? I know this was a project that you did, but in your genuine life, are you very sustainable?
Well, I mean, I don't overmake things. So in other words, I just don't oversaturate the market. Yeah. I don't do trend-driven things. So in other words, it should be relevant in 20 years' time.
Yeah.
So in terms of that, and concerning fast fashion, we like to work with that. Also, we repurpose as much as we can. We try not to do wastage. So just keeping, those are small little things that you can do, but at least like keep your footprint as light as possible.
Exactly, I'm obsessed with those leather pants. I have about 6 pairs of leather pants. I love them. It's all I wear in winter. It's basically like a second skin.
It's amazing. Yeah, exactly. Lush. And also timeless. Fine. Exactly. It's going to be a classic forever.
Now this is chic.
Yes.
Ah, that collar.
Yeah, so
also
that's
very
also
futuristic.
Yes, but it's got a bit of an African vibe. It's got the futuristic. And also just the shapes of the collars, if you look at like beautiful huts and things like that. So taking the landscape and then being inspired.
And how was this received in Portugal?
Oh, they loved it. Absolutely. Yeah.
Because women love to dress up.
Yes, they do.
They're not shy of an outfit.
And those women, they dress beautifully. Yeah. So no, that went down really, really well. So it was quite fun.
Love. And I love how it's still so covered and yet very sheer. It's so elegant.
I think a woman can look really attractive and sexy when she's covered, but something's just peeking through.
Oh, hello. Claudia Henkel still has it. Wow. You know, you love women, and I can see it in your shapes because you cut where it's the most beautiful part of
this
a woman.
This is most beautiful underneath here. Yeah, exactly. I think, you know, being a female designer, I design for women.
Exactly.
Because, we want to look edgy, but we also want to look hot. You know, we want to look sexy. We want to look smart and intelligent and sexy as well. So, work with the body.
Claudia, come and have a seat with us.
I was just getting into it now.
I know. You're not too ready for the ramp. I mean, you have it. It's incredible.
Listen, when you're wearing a garment like this, you have to have just got it.
Of course, but now you're no stranger to Suzaan's outfits. I mean, yes. You've worn a good couple of her ramp shows.
I love it. I love her. You know, it's funny, it's very rarely do you meet a designer where you actually put on a garment and you don't have to nip and tuck or make longer in my case. I mean, it just fits.
It fits beautifully.
You actually have to wear this to an event. I'm obsessed with it.
It's amazing. Amazing, amazing, amazing. And I did it well because my nail colour's
matched. Yeah, perfect.
Yeah, I'm ready to go.
Well, thank you so much for bringing your collection in, and thank you so much for being such an amazing model.
Yeah.
Absolutely gorgeous clothes. But fashion is hard work. I'm sure you're starving. Here's Bonnie and Danilo. I'm sure they're finished with all that delicious food.
Our budgies are done.
Okay.
Your budgies.
Being a gentleman,
it's
Danilo.
It's weird they're called budgies, but it's basically a finger food. It's a really nice start if you've got
some. You see, this is why I like not being a model anymore.
you wouldn't be able to eat this.
To eat all this.
Yeah.
Right.
That's amazing.
Would this you is, like one? Yeah, or you honest?
I'd love a budgie,
no food
darling.
Diet.
Make sure you catch Top Billing this evening at 7:30 on SABC3. Nico takes a trip to Cape Town to learn more about the performers behind Madame Zingara's Theatre of Dreams. Bonang catches up with a number of South African celebrities in London, including Pearl Toosey and Minnie Dlamini, for an interview with Pharrell Williams. Jonathan meets up with Ghanaian soccer star John Mensah, who shows him a unique local perspective of the beautiful African country. There you go.
Good.
Cheers, guys. Awesome.
What is in this?
So it's basically deep fried red onions. It's got a whole bunch of chili and Indian spices involved in it. And the raita is not actually tahini, it's raita, I think is how you pronounce it. It's basically a Greek yogurt, kind of like a Greek yogurt, really double thick yogurt. Mm-hmm. Cucumbers, also cumin, spices.
Mm. Oh, I'm going to make
very impressive. Yeah. Mm.
So tomorrow we have a really exciting show.
Very exciting. So tomorrow on the show we have the gorgeous and talented Nomza Mombatha, an actress who stars in a film called Tell Me Sweet Something, opposite Maps Maponyane. And she'll be on the show in the first 10 minutes of the show. So do tune in right up front. Don't miss out.
And she's dating Maps in real life. Jealousy.
Thank you so much, ladies, for being with us today and for enjoying my food. I hope it is going to be one of you guys to make it home. Mm, with the rest of you in South Africa, good night. Happy eating.
Yeah. Ciao.
Coming up tomorrow on Afternoon Express, we end Women's Month in style. Actress Leanne Van Roy talks about her latest stage show, Woman Alone, and local artist Candy performs live.
Another feel-good production.